Welcome everyone, I'm Norman Wildberger, and today we're going to be talking about polygonal shapes. We're moving a little bit towards some geometry now to balance all of the arithmetic that we've been learning about, so we get to teach our young people about some geometrical shapes and actually get them to play around with some physical objects, which is fun. Okay, so today we're going to be looking at some familiar shapes, just made up from some line segments, and here is a triangle with three sides, a quadrilateral with four sides, a pentagon with five sides, and a hexagon with six sides. So these are all called polygonal shapes, and that tells us that the sides of these things are all straight lines or straight line segments in this case, because they're actually finite in extent. These are all examples of what we call polygons. So there's actually higher polygons also where we increase the number of sides. But we're going to be concentrating today just on these simpler ones, especially the triangle and quadrilateral cases, which are the most important for applications. Now, each of these four kinds of shapes or tiles come in a wide variety of different possibilities. And amongst those possibilities, the regular ones, the ones that are most symmetric, are particularly pleasing and important. So let's have a look at the regular polygons: the triangle, quadrilateral, pentagon, and hexagon. So here we have three sides, and the sides are all the same. They are the same in the sense that, well, we could take that side there, and if we actually moved it physically, then we could overlap it with any of the other sides. It's a kind of an elementary way of saying what we mean by the sides are being the same. In terms of transforming the thing, picking it up and moving it around and plopping it back down again. Here is a regular quadrilateral, has four equal sides. It's, of course, a square, which we're very familiar with. Here is a rather tricky one. It's hard to actually draw this thing accurately. It's a regular pentagon, has five equal sides. And here, the regular hexagon, which is actually quite a beautiful and important tiling, is got six equal sides. Now, these things are regular in a very strong sense. So it's not just that the sides are all equal, but also the vertices are all equal. So in other words, if you're looking at this pentagon from this corner, or this vertex, it looks the same as it does from any other corner or vertex. Right? So another way of saying that is we could pick this thing up and move it around, twist it, and lay it back down again, and it would occupy the same space that it did before. So we're going to have to talk a little bit more about those symmetries, about moving stuff around. That's a kind of an implicit notion, which is actually quite important in geometry, so we'll have to talk about that more, but this is sort of just an informal beginning to that. Okay, so this is sometimes called also an equilateral triangle. So a regular triangle, same thing as an equilateral triangle. And of course, this regular quadrilateral, we've already said that's a square. So these are very pleasant kinds of objects. We should always be on the lookout for physical tools and resources that we can use to demonstrate our mathematical concepts to young people. And here's a great spot to introduce Polydron, which is a commercially available construction set, which uses exactly these kinds of tiles, which can be pleasantly clipped together. So it's called Polydron. And it's a two- and three-dimensional construction system with these interlocking tiles. And I have some examples here that I'm going to show you. Okay, so here are some polydrawn tiles. There is actually a triangle, and here is a square, and here is a pentagon, and here is the biggest one, a hexagon. Now, these things fit together in a very kind of pleasant way, so they have some indentations, and you can't perhaps see, but there's little grooves there that allow you to snap them together. So if you take, let's just say, the triangle and the square, and you put them together so that they're kind of lined up here. There's a bit of elasticity here because of the way things are shaped. So what we can do is we can kind of impose them on top of each other, and then with a little bit of forcing, sort of snap them together. When you've done that, you can sort of see that they fit. And now we have the square and the triangle, the equilateral triangle, attached. And all of them can attach this way. So for example, we could take the hexagon and have to move it appropriately, like this. And then we could snap them together. So now we have the hexagon and maybe a pentagon. We'll put it over here. Okay, so now we have a pentagon there as well, so you see all four tiles, and there's some flexibility along the various joints. But of course we can do a little bit more because we can now kind of fold and make three-dimensional things. So if we snap those together without breaking the whole thing. Okay, so I've made a kind of a, you see it's become solid with those three faces put together there. And then the square could be stuck anywhere somewhere. So there's the possibility of creating all kinds of pleasant three-dimensional shapes with these various tiles. Just these four simple shapes suffice to create actually a wide variety of interesting things. So we're going to have more to say about that when we talk about three-dimensional geometry. But even if you're just in the plane, if we sort of unhook them and just restrict ourselves to the plane, we can still talk about planar surfaces created from these tiles. That's also useful to illustrate various tiling or tessellation kind of problems that we'll be talking about later. So in our investigation of these kinds of tiles or shapes, it's good to start with the quadrilaterals. That's actually probably the richest family and actually the most important. In fact, because we've seen special quadrilaterals already playing an important role in the course so far. So the simplest and most fundamental quadrilaterals are the ones which are regular or pretty well regular. So first of all, the square, okay, which we've already seen is the regular quadrilateral. And then a variant of it, the rectangle, which is a little bit more general and more flexible, where we still have perpendicular sides like we do with the square, okay? Like a piece of paper, for example, is of course a rectangle. Take a book like this, okay? That shape is a rectangle shape, and the sides, the adjacent sides here, are perpendicular, right? That side and that side are perpendicular. So that's a characterizing aspect of the rectangle, that we have perpendicularity at each of the corners or vertices. So adjacent sides are perpendicular. Another property is that opposite sides, like this one and this one, or this one and this one, are parallel, like railway tracks. And actually, of course, they're also the same size. So this side and this side are the same size, in the sense that if you took a segment like this and you lifted it up and plonked it down there, you'd see that it would exactly match. And similarly here, you take that segment there, lift it up and plonk it down there, it exactly matches. So a rectangle has a lot of symmetry, and we've seen rectangles are important. They illustrated multiplication rate from the very beginning. We used rectangles to actually visualize numbers. Number was like a row rectangle of little squares. Okay, so these two are almost surely the most important shapes, actually. Okay, the square and the rectangle. However, there are some other kinds of quadrilaterals which are also very important. So we'll just mention them here, and we'll be talking about the properties of these, or at least some of them, later on. So this one here is a trapezoid. So it's a quadrilateral, it has four sides, but two of them are parallel. This side and this side are parallel. They're in the same direction. Okay. The other two sides, well, there's no direct relation between them. Here is a parallelogram, which is a very important kind of quadrilateral mathematically. It has opposite sides which are parallel in both directions. So these two sides are parallel, but also these two sides are parallel. So there's two kinds of parallelisms in a parallelogram. That's why it's called a parallelogram. Now, a special kind of parallelogram is a rhombus. A rhombus is a parallelogram which has the additional property that all four sides are equal. One way of thinking about what that is that you're sort of starting with a square and then you're kind of leaning it over. Okay, so four equal sides, but they're no longer necessarily perpendicular. But opposite sides are still parallel. And then a weaker kind of shape, which is still also interesting and very familiar to kids, is a kite shape, where we have something like this, where these two sides are equal, and these two sides are also equal. So there's actually one more rather common distinguished type, and I'll leave you to sort of guess what that might be. So the family of quadrilaterals is actually quite rich, and there's quite a lot of interesting things to explore about all of them. Now, people who have been trained in classical Greek geometry might think that sort of triangles are the natural starting point because they only have three sides, and then you go to quadrilaterals and then to pentagons and so on. But actually, if you go back earlier to an earlier mathematical tradition, to that of the Babylonians, you find that the ancient Babylonians considered rectangles and trapezoids to be more fundamental than triangles. That's an interesting point, okay? So we should think about that maybe the rectangles and the trapezoids have a kind of more substantial, more direct connection with our world. So from the Babylonian point of view, triangles were sort of secondary things that you could get by splitting rectangles or trapezoids accordingly. So here are some important kinds of triangles. The equilateral triangle, which we've already seen, and the right triangle, and a special case, the isosceles right triangle. But we might start with this one because this one's obtained from arguably the simplest quadrilateral, the square, by taking the square and making a diagonal line, okay? Then cuts that square into two pieces, each of which is essentially the same shape, and that shape is an isosceles right triangle. So what properties does it have? Well, it has three sides, and two of the sides are perpendicular because they're coming from a square. But these two perpendicular sides are also equal, because in a square, all four sides are equal. All right, so the isosceles right triangle is a very fundamental kind of triangle, which has two equal sides, which are also perpendicular. So slightly more generally, if we take a more general rectangle, we can still do the same kind of thing. We can draw a diagonal line that cuts the shape into two triangles. So here, this triangle here is a right triangle. It has still the property that these two sides are perpendicular because it's coming from a rectangle and the adjacent sides of a rectangle are perpendicular. But it's no longer the case that the two sides are equal. So it's just a general right triangle. These are very important kinds of triangles in mathematics. Very important, okay? So when the ancient Babylonians thought about triangles, typically they thought about this. This was your typical triangle for a Babylonian. More general triangles with sort of arbitrary three sides or more arbitrary was of less interest, actually. And actually, it's more complicated in some way. Okay? Very rich, but somehow more complicated than these special kinds of triangles coming from rectangles and squares, and this sort of naturally symmetrical and elegant equilateral triangle, which is always going to be important. Now there is one more important family of triangles called isosceles triangles, and these are the triangles that have two equal sides. But we've seen one special case where the isosceles right triangle had two equal sides, but we can talk about more general isosceles triangles. And if we continue with our story of taking a quadrilateral and sort of imposing a diagonal to cut it into two triangles, then we can get at these ones by taking a rhombus. Okay, so let me remind you, a rhombus was a quadrilateral shape that was sort of like a square leaning. Okay, so it has four equal sides, and opposite sides are parallel. So it's a parallelogram with four equal sides. Now, such a rhombus, these are supposed to be the same, can be cut in two different ways with diagonals. That actually gives you different kinds of constituent triangles. So we can cut this diagonal here, we get this kind of shape, and then these two sides are going to be equal, right? Because they are two of four equal sides of the rhombus, so they're going to be equal in this triangle. So that's an example of an isosceles triangle. We could take the same rhombus over here, and instead of cutting along here or drawing a line here, we can draw a line between these two corners or vertices. And then we get a splitting of the rhombus into two triangles that look like this one here. And this is still going to be an isosceles triangle, but quite a different shape from this one. Okay, but it still has two equal sides because we're taking two of the equal sides, the four equal sides of the rhombus. Okay, so those are isosceles triangles, and they also, they're kind of symmetrical, not quite as symmetrical as the equilateral triangle, but still they are very common in practice, so they're an important family of triangles. Okay, so here's a little exercise for us to count some triangles and identify what kinds of triangles can be found in these relatively simple diagrams. So here's a square with two diagonals displayed. Here is a rhombus, also with its two diagonals. Here's a rectangle with its two diagonals, and here is a parallelogram with its two diagonals. Okay, so we're taking four of the important kinds of quadrilaterals and considering both the diagonals. And we want to now ask, well, what kind of triangles then are formed by this picture, and what kinds of triangles are they? So let me just answer that for the square, and the other ones are somewhat similar. So in the square, there's a number of different triangles that we can see. First of all, there's these triangles that are formed by a side of the original square and this sort of central point. So that triangle there, for example, if we look at that, it's an isosceles right triangle. So this side and this side turn out to be the same, and they're actually perpendicular. So that's an isosceles right triangle. And so this one is also, and this one is also, and this one is also. So there's four of those. But there's also the bigger isosceles right triangles that are exactly the ones that we talked about before, where we just consider one diagonal. So if you take the square and you just consider that single diagonal, then it cuts it into two bigger isosceles right triangles, that one and that one. But now since we have the diagonal, we can also consider the other two, this one here and this one here. So we get four of these bigger isosceles right triangles. So we get four smaller ones and four larger ones. And you might want to consider what happens with these more general situations, what kinds of triangles do we get? And here's another one, slightly different, where we're kind of cutting up an equilateral triangle. So here's an equilateral triangle, and we're supposedly cutting it along these lines here. So we're cutting it in half, okay? So that's supposed to be cutting in half. That's also cutting in half. That's cutting in half. And it's not too hard to see that this there's a sort of a symmetry center there, so that all these lines meet there. And so it's a little bit trickier, perhaps, to count how many triangles there are all together there. So that's a little more challenging exercise. And to see if any of them are right triangles, or if any of them are isosceles triangles, or if any of them are isosceles right triangles. Okay, so that's great. So we had sort of an informal introduction to these basic shapes. In my next video, I want to talk a little bit about how some of these shapes can tile the plane. So this example of tiling, where we put tiles together to form a nice pattern, typically with some regularity. It's a very big subject, but it's a topic that young people can appreciate and can actually move things around. Okay, so tiling in the plane with some basic shapes next time. Hope you'll join me for that. I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for listening.